the entire world with all the different indigenous peoples, their tribes, that originally were on these lands. So you see what is probably like a lot of overlapping blobs? Those all designate areas where tribes and original indigenous people to North America and Australia and South America all lived. So if we look at ours, our location, does anybody have an idea of like who they think? Before I reveal it, Nick?
No stress, but you're live, right?
Oh my god, okay.
And
thank you.
I know we're zooming in like right in this area.
Just right on your
what
face.
Did you say?
Yeah.
I still can't hear you.
Navajo.
No, we do not. No. Jerry, you already answered. Kane, you already answered. Dee.
No Cherokee and actually no Sioux.
Ho-Chunk is one. Can you guys think of
that?
Starts with an N. Go, Nick. Menominee. So if I pull back, oh yeah, you guys were right. Sorry, I forgot that these overlap. So if we're approximating, anybody want to point out where they think we are, Montello, on the map? Go up there. Go up there, Nick. Tell us. Where are we at? Approximately, where are we located?
There,
yep. So overlapping, if you click on this, overlapping us is... We have the Sioux, which you guys were right, I was wrong about the Sioux. The Sioux, Menominee, but if you continue clicking, you can see that there's a bunch of different, Anishinaabe, thank you. I always mispronounce that. But there's all kinds of different tribes that once belonged in this area. Sioux, Miami, Ho-Chunk, or Winnebago. We had that opportunity to go and meet with Bill Quackenbush last year, which was really cool. He kind of talked about that stewardship of the land. And what he was taught, and then we have Sauk and Peoria. So we're kind of in this mix of different tribes that all existed at some point, all these indigenous people that exist at some point on this land, and continues to be their land, despite the fact that they might not, they may no longer be here. So I just want to be able to acknowledge that and say that just because we live here, just because you might have been born in Portage or Montello or Princeton or Packwaukee, wherever, doesn't mean that you and your people have always been here. There have been other people that came before you. And I think, Jarrett, you brought up something that when I think of sustainability, that's what I think of, and it's called the seventh generation. That you, when you make a decision and it impacts the natural world or the social world, you want to think seven generations ahead. How is your choice, how is you choosing to use the plastic utensil impacting seven generations ahead of you? Because as we're going to find out, it does not go away in seven generations. So I always think of that when I think of sustainability. How are my choices, the clothes I purchase, the food I eat, the vehicle I drive, the place I choose to live, the education I pursue, how is that going to impact seven generations ahead of me? Nick?
Put that in perspective. Like, it's really hard to trace back that far family tribe. So, like, that's a long time ago. Seven generations. Like, there's only seven generations in my entire family. So, think about that.
Yeah.
It's like seven generations.
You're live, girl.
I know. It's like a legit question. It's not even on topic.
Raise your hand. Go ahead, Josh.
Seven generations, like, so an even simpler way to think about that is your kids, however many times seven, right? There's gonna be your great grandkids, something like that. And you want them to be happy, right? They may not know who you are, but what you've done impacts them. If that makes sense. And if we don't recycle recycle things. We have a bunch of landfills, and some of that stuff they burn it, but a bunch of it is thrown underground, and it may not be too big of an issue now, but then it will be. Like 7 generations later, we're gonna live like Wally. Nobody knows how to walk.
Alright, let's have Sakaius for a question because we gotta get back on track. It's 8:29.
Was 7 generations, is that like 1400s?
Yeah.
For us?
Yeah. Like,
you're asking me to do math.
Are you asking what 7 generations is?
How far back for us right now?
I mean, it'd be 140 years, right? So
yeah.
Generations are about 20 years.
So you're probably
generations are about 20 years?
Yeah, you're too far back.
What?
Yeah.
I thought generations was like a human's lifetime.
No, because it's about reproduction of generations, right?
Yep.
So like,
when you have babies.
So my mom is 25 years older than me.
Yep.
My mom had me at 17.
Anyway, Sakai has a talking piece. And we are, just as a reminder, we are live.
I'm checking for the audio.
Huh?
I'm checking the audio right now.
Oh, okay, perfect. So keep that in mind as we go through all of our presentations this morning. The other thing I want to bring up before we get into the logo design reveal is all the sponsors that hold this event. You guys, many of you have t-shirts from last year that have all the sponsors on the back of the shirts. You will also receive t-shirts this year that have the sponsors on the back of the shirts, and I think it's important for you guys to recognize that this is not just something that happens because a bunch of adults are on a planning team. It's because we have support from all these different organizations, like Conserve School, the Wisconsin Wildlife Federation, the Hmong American Sportsmen, Buck Lake Sportsman Club, the EPA, and the Natural Resources Foundation of Wisconsin. So this thing, this youth summit, many youth summits, many that you guys have been to every single year, they're not possible without that support. So, speaking of Conserve School, I want to jump in and play their video for you guys so you guys can see what Conserve School is like. Many of you guys might remember Alitha, who went to Conserve School for a semester and really enjoyed it. Some of you guys are really interested in going to Conserve School for a semester. So I'm going to play this video so you guys can get a better idea of what Conserve School is like.
Conserve School is a place that I consider home, a place that I consider to, you know, always be able to come back to.
Conserve School is a community of compassionate individuals who share a common love for sustainability, environmental stewardship, and the outdoors.
Conserve School offers a chance to step out of your comfort zone while also maintaining a safe structure, environment.
Well, at Conserve School, students engage in a comprehensive college preparatory set of classes, which include an entire year of advanced placement environmental science completed in just one semester, experiential English and history courses, and an engaging outdoor skills class that leads them into the woods for solo camping experiences and week-long adventures.
Camping alone in the woods offered a sense of wonder that I don't usually get in group camping, where it was just me and the trees.
Being able to go on a 5 or 6 day backpacking trip in a place as beautiful as Pictured Rocks was really eye-opening.
Beforehand, I was a bit nervous about whether or not I was going to be able to keep up with everybody in my group, whether or not I was going to be too cold or anything like that. 11 miles a day.
Being located in Wisconsin gives us the opportunity to experience the woods of Conserve School through a variety of seasons.
And I think that all the classes, you know, are unique in their own way. You get to go outside and try new things in the classes.
And I've never had teachers, like, go out of their way to, like, support your knowledge, because they really want you to learn here. It's not about, like, meeting deadlines as much as it is about them wanting you to, like, retain the knowledge and learn and grow.
So something that you learn about in English, you read about in history, which then you'll see an example of outside in science, and then you'll reference that in art class. Everything's just really interconnected.
Stewardship to me means caring for and being aware of your surroundings.
I've learned that being a steward to the environment means building a relationship with the environment, advocating for it, trying to gain a better sense of knowledge about things, asking questions.
I think that Conserve School is a chance for adventure.
I know I'll always want to come back to Conserve School. It's a very powerful feeling.
Conserve School is life-changing, absolutely life-changing.
It's incredible.
Unforgettable. Unforgettable.
Plus it's just, it's like not project-based, it's more.
Yeah, I mean, so the classes you would take would be AP classes, but the way, because it's a semester, it's going to feel more like the work that you're doing here. It just might feel a little bit more structured.
It's a private school, isn't it?
Yes.
How much is tuition, you know?
It's a sliding scale that's made available. They make it available to England. They have an endowment that they're able to. The question I can't really answer because it depends on you and your ability, your income, and that sort of thing. So they make it available to anyone. Also, their math is Alex.
Of course it is.
So, other thoughts, ideas, questions, feelings?
It's just math. It's not math.
Sure.
So is it right, isn't it just juniors and seniors, right? In high school, right?
Yes, I believe so.
Okay. That's what I thought, but I don't know. It's been a while since I've saw the Conserve School again, so.
Could you speak at all to Alika's experience? I don't know if she ever talked to you or your sister about it.
She talked a little bit about it. It definitely like changed her and definitely made her a better leader, I feel like, you know, from what Allison kind of told me. That made her a better leader, considering that she kind of had to be, kind of like, it was different because she wasn't used to everybody, so she kind of, it made her better in that way, being a better leader, I guess, from what I understood of it.
I don't want to muddy the waters and make this complicated, but.
Yeah.
Where is it located?
So it's.
Land O'Lakes.
Land O'Lakes.
Just on the boundary of the upper.
And it's amazing.
Right by my family, my in laws.
Mr. Krim and I have gone many summers for No Teacher Left Inside, formerly known as No Teacher Left Inside, but it's a really beautiful campus.
Jared? What are the requirements in order to go to Conserve School?
Excellent question. It says if you're interested in learning more, you can explore their website, which I would encourage you to do.
I thought I knew that.
But I would say if you really are interested, you like this is something after watching this video, or I even can connect you, because I know for some of you who have been interested, I connect you with Aletha. You can come and talk to us later about that, and we can get you onto the website and connected with Conserve School to answer some of your questions.
And we both know the director, Stefan, who is in the video there, and my friend and colleague on the WAE board is there. I forget exactly what her title is, but she's student admissions, basically, student. So we have a lot of contacts there, and they would love to have our students. Should we move on to the recognize the...
Yeah, let's do that. Okay. So we're going to move on to the really cool part, too. Oh, I was like, where are they? Because I've been wondering where they were. So I want to recognize that we had two people submit art for the t-shirt design, and it was Elliot and it was Dale, two of your high mark classmates. And the both of your particular pieces were very similar. They had a lot of really good symbols of what the theme this year was going to be for Youth Summit, which is Connect, Explore, Engage. So the WGSN staff took it upon themselves.
So I won't hand them out yet.
Oh, I have it. I have it.
Oh, you have it.
Yeah, I think I put it somewhere in the back. So they decided to take that and create a design inspired by both individuals' drawings. And this is what they created. And because we have such awesome people in and connected to this school, Mr. Prim's mom last night went to go pick up the shirts so that you guys would actually have them today and that we could celebrate the shirts in person. Paula,
wait for it.
Yeah, Paula,
wait for it, wait for it. Can you get off camera for a second?
And Mr. Prim already put
surprise! I'm wearing one right now! Whoa!
Ian.
So that he can just give you the shirt and then you can hand it to the right person.
You gotta be quicker than that if you're going up against Jared. Yeah, clearly. You gotta be quicker
than
against Jared.
You gotta climb over him. Demand your spot.
Oh, also, FYI, Susan is watching live.
Right, this is Kenny.
Hey, oh, hi, Susan.
Love you.
Nicholas.
Hello, we're all.
We hope you're staying warm.
they? Mm. They knew about this.
Make sure they hear the right sound. Dee Dee. And then. Dill.
I know, they're really cool. Like when Mr. Grimm sent me the picture,
Jillian.
The text looked more purple than anything.
Yeah, you're my personal teacher.
Oh, yes. Even better than an actual teacher. Jared is our teacher. If you have access, hey folks, can I get your attention really quick?
Sakai.
If you have a writing utensil that you would like to go and grab, you may do so. Otherwise, there is a bucket you can pass around with writing utensils.
Thank you.
Actually, you know what? We'll make it fancy because I have this whole step right here.
Yes, you go bowling.
Yeah, okay. Who wants a high mark? Cool little high mark.
You get a pen.
Wow, you're
you
so
get
Oprah.
A pen.
Mr. Prince Ellen and
Elliot,
Oprah.
This is one of
actually,
Elliot's
I appreciate
ones.
That comparison very much. All right, I'm not throwing
folks,
it.
Folks, if you cross over into Ms. Boland's advisory, just watch out. There's a cord across the
yes,
door
definitely.
To plug in the camera. If you trip on that cord,
right,
you'll pull the camera down. So
let's
just be careful.
Chelsea.
Demonstrate that these pens can click. Let's refrain from the excessive clicking. Seriously, guys, you're live on camera.
TJ. You get t-shirts for your families.
Yeah.
All right. Jasper. Oh, yeah.
It doesn't have your name, your last name on it fully.
Oh, and
so I think
no,
this
it's
is the
Earth
final.
Thing. We had
yeah,
them change that.
Yeah.
We thought
so
it looked too busy and weird.
I agree.
Yeah, we made that change, or at least I remember. We
yeah,
talked about it.
That's true. Yeah.
We were like,
so
that's
this
weird.
Is like in my brain. That looks
Mr. Hensel.
Because this was the first draft, and then what you guys see it is. You guys have seen the final draft.
Yeah.
It wasn't
nice. Caden. The t-shirt based portion of our
yes.
show. Does everyone have a shirt?
Who
did anyone not receive a shirt? Pretty sure I got everybody.
Yeah, no one's exclaiming.
All right, we got exactly the right. Good job, Emma, if you're
Woo,
watching.
Good job.
She had to organize these.
Yeah, thank goodness for her. I very much appreciate that. Okay, so now we're going to actually start with presentations. And I'm going to take 2 minutes and we'll get ready for the first presentation. I think the first person presenting is not Joshua. Okay. I know, I heard you. It's amazing, that hearing that I have. And I'm going to explain to you guys why you have these sheets of paper. So our first one is going to be Alexis. So this is going to be the... Here's our schedule for presenters. And some people are absent, so they're not obviously going to be presenting. But going first is Alexis, then it will be Sam and Eden, then Paris, then Aidan, then Dee Dee, and then Sakai. Then we have lunch, and then in the afternoon we're going to come back. Elliot will present, then Jarrett, Jillian, Josh, and see, I don't know why you're backwards, David, but you know,
Pictures
of David, auto detailing is presenting about David Conger. Okay, that would be really cool. So I want to explain to you guys why you have these particular sheets of paper. So go ahead and pull them out from under your seats so that you can see. So these are the actual feedback forms that the judges at U Summit, when we go to the formal U Summit, these are the forms that they use when they are watching you guys present. So I thought it'd be really cool if you guys had the opportunity to basically give feedback and fill out these forms for your classmates. Obviously, we're not going to have every single one of you do one of these forms for every single presentation, because that means that your classmates will be getting 20 forms to read through, which is, it's a bit much. So you each have two, and I have three extra ones. What I'm going to ask you guys to do is to pick at random two presentations that you're going to complete the form for. I would really like for every presenter to have at least three forms from different students giving them feedback on their presentation. David?
Can I do mine on my own?
What do you mean?
Can I write this for my
own? Obviously, I mean, okay. Hold on, let me make sure I make that clear. You guys should not be giving feedback to yourselves. You should be giving feedback to other presentations. So really quickly going through this, note that you're not putting your own name on here, because it doesn't say your name. It says presentation title, and then the student's name and school. So obviously, you guys are all Hamer, you don't have to call it school, but you should put down your classmates' names. And then here are the categories. Does the presentation fit the theme, connect, explore, engage with sustainability? And here's how you know that they have accomplished it. Student clearly explains how the project relates to the summit's theme throughout the presentation. Addresses sustainability in the following categories: ecological, economic, cultural, engineering and design, agriculture and nutrition research, and or the arts. Student clearly explains how the project fits into the chosen category and gives multiple clear examples in one category, or gave clear examples across multiple categories. Deepen the knowledge base of others related to the sustainability topic. Student clearly articulates sustainability information and engage with audience through discussion and by answering questions. Include evidence of benefits to the community. Student provides multiple pieces of evidence of benefits, photos, videos, anecdotes, or data. Include reflections on ways that learning is transferable to other communities and or future problems or challenges that we may face. Student shares the ways that knowledge, skills, and understandings can be applied to new situations. Explains why this project is important to share with others. Student explains and provides examples as to why it is important that others learn about this project, including from the audience perspective. Format and delivery, PV legs, enhance the intended message. PV legs and visuals, so presentation format, essentially, and visuals all assist the audience's understanding of the message. And then you can leave comments and notes in each of those sections. Please keep to our feedback protocol, which is be helpful, specific, and kind. So, like we talked about 2 days ago, and it's like, okay, this is crazy, because my graduate school class that I had this week, we had this conversation where the language that you use when you're giving feedback is really important. Often, you guys want to give feedback that's like, well, you had a lot of errors in there. Try flipping that around. So when you're giving feedback, written feedback on here, try restructuring it. Just like I did with Josh earlier, right? You had a lot of don't examples, correct? And I was like, what about some do examples? Reframe the feedback that you're going to give in that perspective. What could they have done? Think of how we have you guys sometimes write feedback. I think, I wonder, what if? Try to use those as your sentence starters as you're giving that feedback. So rather than saying, like, slow down, write in, like, maybe next time you might want to take your time or pause and take a breath. Think about what they could be doing rather than just pointing out, like, well, you misspelled astronauts, which actually did happen to Ms. Bolin in class. You misspelled it, like, three times. Maybe next time you might want someone to proofread your work so that you don't misspell things. Much better way of reframing that. You guys see what I'm doing? I think you guys can definitely do this. Caden, you had a really good piece of feedback 2 days ago that was really cool. Instead of saying,
which I think a lot of your classmates in that particular opportunity were saying, like, you shouldn't have a lot of fillers when you're speaking, or you say a lot, or you say You reframe. And you said you should be mindful of how many fillers you're using in your presentations when you talk. I love that. Think of it in terms of that. Think of it in terms of our social pillars. So, if you're unsure, you can always raise your hand and we can help you kind of reframe that language and be thinking about how can we spin this into a do example rather than a don't example. Are you guys ready for this? Yes, ma'am. Yes, you may. I have three other forms. Are there people that would be willing to do three? Oh, Katie, you're already volunteered. Now, if you're willing to do three presentations, there's another one for Garrett.
Two more under my seat.
Then you have somebody else's. Because you should only have two.
I think they put an extra one on that seat. It's for Mason, and he wasn't here.
Oh, then I'll take those. I guess I have more. Who wants to do more than two presentations? You already got one. You got three.
We don't worry about that.
Who else? Ooh, Shelly. Give that to Shirley, please. One more.
Oh, sorry.
One more. Yeah. I was going to make really awkward, uncomfortable eye contact with Darla and be like, come on, Darla. But then you still pointed to you and I was like, oh. Because how can, like, she's awesome. How cool is Darla? She's the coolest. She just, like, she is. Like, if you have ever had to do testing with her, she's, like, hilarious.
She's crazy.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Because I know, like, if
all right, guys, let's focus. Josh has a question.
I'm making it around.
Ask questions.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, well, I'm going to make sure before I did it. So I'm not just, like, sitting here the whole time. Yes. Presenters, I'm still going to hold you to the same expectations that you would at U Summit. So you should be at least 7 minutes and not try to go over. Yeah.
I think she cares.
You should have dressed up nice, like Mr. Aidan Summit. Please make sure that you're treating this just like you would at U Summit, because you are live. You're going to be streamed. And Susan's watching right now, but we're hoping that other people will be watching it too. I also opened this up to the entire school. So if at any point teachers who are on their prep or want to bring their classes in could be coming in and watching presentations from you guys.
Oh,
surprise! I really, like...
Alexis is like bringing in a special guest just in a second.
Like I said yesterday, I admire so much your amazing ability to be resilient and to persevere. I want this to be a really cool opportunity that opens up our door, both physically and literally and metaphorically, to our entire community, to show off the amazingness that you guys have demonstrated over the last 2 weeks, getting ready for U Summit. So if you're a little embarrassed or feeling awkward or nervous, that's okay. You should feel a little bit of that, because this is a really cool opportunity for us to open our doors. Dill, you had your hand up earlier and then you put it down. Do you still have a question? Yeah, because I actually really need to go too, so yes.
Can I also give a quick presentation note? You're going to want to be on the camera, which you should want to be.
Or we're going
to
look at you.
You should be here,
pushing,
like on this side of this, or between that and the screen. That's the field of view. It's like, as well,
oh,
as
so
probably barely
see
on
me.
The screen right now. So it goes from here to, you know, around here, basically. Okay?
Sweet.
Got it? Presenters?
Got it.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Nick. This is Nick putting less nervous.
Every time they ask questions, okay. This happens. Are other schools doing this, I guess?
Yes, that's the hope, that other schools are also doing a use of it style at their school.
I think we're the people.
I mean, we are pretty cool.
We're definitely the only ones that I know are live streaming.
Yeah.
And they're sharing this live stream with some of the other schools. So
they're probably gonna
Getting to connect with the classmates that you would have been able to connect with.
And if we have comments and stuff, I will try to make sure I share those out.
What do you think of Facebook? GT. I share
with
my 384.
Yeah, give me one more second. Okay, any other final questions before I give you guys a 5 minute break for bathroom?
Yeah.
All right, 5 minute break for bathroom or getting something hard to write on, like a clipboard or a notebook or whatever, not your Chromebook.
Are you allowed to eat?
You may grab something, and I will make sure that we get snacks. Actually, Nick, if you grab snacks, and make sure we get snacks. That would be
hello, camera.
Take one. If you run out completely,
those are the same, but one of those.
snacks for? Didi was like, you have two snacks. And I was like, who did I just grab snacks from? And she like popped one to lunch.
You're gonna have to dig for the jelly.
It's on Facebook and Twitter. I mean, like to it.
So they spelled the same way too. So,
yeah,
long lost brother. That's the fact. Good to meet you.
You just ate.
Are you going to introduce me to your friends here?
You know him, though.
But you could also reintroduce.
Michael.
I do remember you.
Hi, Michael.
Oh, God.
Yeah, there is a link on Facebook. Yeah. Okay. Alexis, you know this would happen. You're a stranger, especially a boy.
Can I turn out in the snow? I figured you'd be snowshoeing or something.
No, they were supposed to go to Youth Summit, but it got canceled, so we're hosting it here.
It's really nice.
Yeah. Well, so you're not on. Yeah.
I mean, it's late, so you might not
be on. Minute.
So Alexis is gonna get started. If you are present, like you're the next person, so for example, the next peoples after Alexis are Eden and Sam, they're in the other room practicing. So I will let you know if you're the next presenter. You can go into my advisory and you can practice and get your stuff together if you need to. But otherwise, the expectation is everybody's in here watching. Okay?
Garrett's in there.
Yeah, Garrett's in there helping. Alright.
Remember, you needed to be standing.
I know.
Were you here?
I'll ask him after.
You
were
in the room, though. Here.
Any other questions?
Through here. That's your live space. Yep.
Alright. Whenever you're ready, Alexis. Stand over here. Remember, you're picking at least two. Not everybody's going to do Alexis right now, but a handful of people are going to do their reviews for Alexis.
Bolin introduced me, and you all should know my name because otherwise you're slackers and you suck. So,
I'm sorry. Live stream. Let's
is it really?
Refrain from saying things like that.
Yeah, there's people from UWC Point watching you right now. Emma is watching you right now. Susan's watching. Yeah. Let's reframe. How about that?
Okay.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Alexis Drager. I'm from High Marq Environmental Charter School, which is where we are right now. And I'm a freshman, and this is my project on George Archibald. This project has humble origins in the field project, where we and our field teams did projects on different conservation leaders from Wisconsin. My team chose George Archibald. So most of this work was not really done altogether by myself, although this has had a lot added to it since I presented it with my team. So that being said, what did he do? George Archibald was one of the co-founders of the International Crane Foundation, which is located in Baraboo, Wisconsin, and has led and continues to lead efforts around the world for protection of cranes and crane habitats everywhere, because cranes are everywhere, not just in the United States. So is understanding for natural and cultural systems. Pretty cool guy. Dr. Archibald has a PhD, which he earned at Cornell University in 1977. While he was there, he kept a collection of birds that he called the cranium, and he studied all different species and kept breeding pairs and just learned all about them. Well, he was most famous for was dancing with Tex for 5 years every breeding season until she laid a fertile egg, which became G-Wiz, who was a male whooping crane. She's also a whooping crane. That became the father to over 44 chicks that improved the population greatly. So, Dr. Archibald has seen the decline in cranes and around the world. In his love for them, he took proactive steps to preserve these great birds, from establishing breeding programs to campaigning for the protection of the cranes, native wetlands and areas. Dr. Archibald has been working with cranes for over half a century and learning everything he can about them. So his family structure and early influences. George was born in New Glasgow, Nova Scotia, Canada. And his mother, Letty, and father, David, were teachers and had extreme passions for nature and for learning. And so that translated into George, as he loved learning about all the nature around their farm. And they kept different flocks of birds, like ducks and chickens. He had chickens himself. And he really found interesting the migratory patterns of birds even early on and wondered what it could be that caused these birds to want to do this. And so he's the second born of six children, two girls and four boys. And they all shared a close relationship with each other and nature. His fascination with cranes began in 1954 when he was 8 years old. At school, he heard a radio broadcast about the whooping crane and their native breeding nesting grounds and their migratory patterns from the southern United States all the way up to Canada. And ever since then, he's been learning everything he can about the crane. So his other influences were, Dr. Archibald was deeply moved by the Sand County Almanac and all the sentiments enclosed by Elder Leopold about cranes and other nature and animals and stuff like that. And so he always wanted to visit the shack, which is where the Sand County Almanac was primarily written. And he got to do so when he met a friend, his college friend, Ron Sowey, whose farm was 10 miles away from the shack. And so he got to visit there and enjoys visiting it still to this day, because he still lives near there. So struggles faced when starting the ICF with Ron, they were very short on money. The ICF itself, the International Crane Foundation itself, belonged to Ron's parents, and it was a horse barn, all that kind of stuff. And they rented it to them for $1 a year, so that they were able to have the land and work with it and stuff. And so they didn't have much money, and George grew up in a Irish household, and so they were very tight. They worked hard and didn't spend much, and so he was very familiar with living frugally and operating a business under that fashion. And so with that, there was many hard years faced trying to operate like that. But they did well. Ron died in 1986 after a Christmas Day incident, and then just a couple weeks into the new year, he passed away. And so although they came from very different backgrounds, Ron and Dr. Archibald were very close friends because they shared a lot of the same outlooks on nature and how they wanted to save it. And so even though they didn't have the same backgrounds, they came from very different backgrounds, they were still one in their mission to save the cranes. Their skills really complemented each other. coming from different backgrounds, where one was lacking, they really helped each other out. And so, also in the winter of 77 to 78, there was an epidemic outbreak at the International Crime Foundation, and despite vigilant efforts by all the staff, for weeks on end, 22 cranes died, and this was really mentally and physically taxing to all of them, and you can imagine why, you know, it's something that they really cared about. For leadership qualities, Dr. Archibald is really soft-spoken, devoted, passionate, and a joyful educator. This makes him the great ambassador that he is for cranes and the natural environment. He's also very modest in all aspects of his career. With no formal training in diplomacy, he simply says that I just had wonderful parents that taught us how to live a decent life. This, as he travels all around the world and works with all cultures, from North Korea to China, Russia, and Afghanistan, he has worked with world leaders and town folk alike to establish agreements to help the cranes. As a someone who's working for this kind of thing, to try and work not only for the good of the nature, but the good of the people, different cultures are very willing to let him come across their borders that wouldn't usually necessarily even let politicians come through, like North Korea and Russia, when things were kind of tough. And so it was really cool to see him breaking down these, you know, walls and getting to do these things because he was working with the people, for the people, and for everything else. He still visits Bhutan annually through and with the ICF and different members. He brings a group annually, and he really respects the Buddhist culture and the relationship they hold with nature and with the cranes. His legacy, Dr. Archibald is still alive, don't get me wrong here, but he's going to be leaving behind a lot of great things. Dr. Archibald says his greatest comfort and sense of peace is that the ICF exists. And I think that really says something. And also that there are all these people here that are helping cranes that he's taught to, and he doesn't feel like he has a greatest achievement, really, because he considers them all rather humble. He leaves behind a world of passionate educators and a newfound knowledge of cranes to be passed on to the next generation. So, other information. This is a portrait of workers of the ICF, like people who worked at the ICF. That's Dr. Archibald, and that's a dog. But that's Dr. Archibald. The dog is just very important because Dr. Archibald has been awarded many awards for his conservation work, including the Gold Medal from the National Wildlife Fund, a Fellows Award from the MacArthur Foundation, Wildlife Conservation Medal from the Zoological Society of San Diego. And in 2013, Dr. Archibald was awarded the Order of Canada on behalf of Queen Elizabeth II and received the inaugural Dan W. Lipkin Award Prize for Environmental Leadership from the National Audubon Society. He has also received other awards, but alongside that, he's also a Wisconsin conservation leader and has a plaque at UW Stevens Point at the Conservation Hall of Fame. And so that's really cool too, because we got to go there and learn actually at this place about all different conservation leaders. He still lives in the Baraboo countryside alongside the ICF with his wife and continues to travel around the world. You should care because cranes are important. Farmers don't really like them, but they're still important, and their environments that they live in are really important too, and so you should care because he really worked very hard for years and years and years and years, and still does, to preserve this, and it's not just a local thing, it's a global thing, and that's really important, you know, that he wasn't just focusing on one area. He serves a really good example of a good leadership style that we could, you know, take an example from. So, acknowledgements and sources, I'd like to acknowledge Dr. George Archibald. We had actual interview from him. We asked him questions, and he gave us personal answers, and that was really cool because he's really busy. And then also from his assistants, Andy Bingle and Karen Becker, for getting us resources. And then to my field team for helping me gather the information in the first place and presenting this with me the first time. And we also have other sources and stuff. So thanks for watching. Any questions?
We'll have 5 minutes for questions, and if you decided to give feedback for Alexis, please complete your forms now. So, questions.
So, was G-Wiz, I'm trying to remember, was G-Wiz the crane that was like half sand hill, half whooping, or was that a different crane?
I think that was a different crane, but I
noticed there was like a difference in picture of G-Wiz.
That was a picture. I didn't have any picture. Well,
I don't know who's that. Crane that was. So
that's you.
Oh, that's okay.
Was there something that stuck out to you when learning about George Archibald? Like, was there a piece of information that made you realize?
I don't know. I thought all of it was really interesting. Just the fact that he was so devoted for all his time and. It wasn't, although it didn't always line up with how most people would like to live, you know, maybe having a lot of money or whatever. He wasn't seeking fame, although he did get a lot of accreditation for what he did. He wasn't looking for that. He was just doing it because it's what he cared about. Katie.
What was your favorite thing that you found while like researching the project, like anything, like research, like just whatever?
I thought it was really cool that he was actually born in Canada in Nova Scotia because, I don't know, it's just a really nice area and I guess it makes sense, but also that he didn't only go to Cornell, but he went to university also in Canada.
How do you relate to him and how do you feel about him?
I really appreciate his leadership style and that he was so like passionate about not only the cranes but teaching others about the cranes and working with other people, and that he was really willing to work with everybody, and that's really cool, you know, because some people will only go so far to help something, but he was willing to risk his life actually to help the cranes and their environments and the future of it. Future of everything. What was the second part of your question?
Do you plan on continuing his work or even like going into an environmental field?
I personally am not planning on going into an environmental field, and the funny thing about this project is that I actually used to hate cranes, like with a burning passion. I despised them. I wanted nothing to do with them. But this kind of gave me an appreciation for them, although I'm not so interested in them that I would be interested in continuing this work. Anymore, so.
Actually, you
want to
give your speech again, Mr. French?
Sure. People from UW-Stevens Point and the Wisconsin Green Schools Network and Susan are all watching us live right now, and also probably other schools. It was just emailed out to all the other schools, I noticed.
Yes, it was.
So just make sure that you think about how professional
supreme.
You are being. Yeah,
don't be
thank
you.
You
missed
it.
Yeah.
You missed it.
Be
so
as
bad.
Scoot
in.
No, you're good. Actually, they're perfect.
All right.
Be professional, be awesome, be supreme. You're already fashionable.
The Hamerstroms were research fellows under Alda Leopold at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Frances became the only woman to earn a graduate degree under Alda Leopold in 1940. In 1941, Frederick became the only person to earn a doctorate under Alda Leopold. Susan Tupper said, "Without a doubt, Alda Leopold was their greatest role model. They were not only students of Leopold, but very good friends who hunted together and spent much time together. The Hamerstroms were able to take Leopold's land ethic and turn it into a practical tool for saving the prairie chickens, thereby demonstrating exactly how Leopold's vision worked in preserving an ecological balance in nature."
Their accomplishments. Fran and Frederick, both authors of several books or articles, for example, To the Forest of the Great Lakes States Cookbook, and A Book of Fran's Childhood Stories. Fran also worked with raptors and
qualities. One of the questions we asked was, what are some of their leadership qualities? Her response was, "I think the Hamerstroms' strongest leadership qualities are a genuine passion for conservation and a desire to pass on their experience and knowledge to the next generation. Fran and Frederick understood that just working in the field was not enough to ensure that the environment in the future would be sustainable. They wanted to leave the world in a better shape than it was during their lifetime. Both Fran and Frederick were outstanding communicators. They had an ability to relate the natural world to an average person in a way that was inspiring and empowering."
Contributions to conservation. Like I said, they already had the project for the prairie chickens. They relocated them to the oil base of the marsh. And they decided to pick this place because of their favorite food was there, which was great. Acres of bluegrass.
Environmental or
because they had more of a passion towards like learning on keeping animal species alive.
I personally don't know
for both of you like separately. What was your favorite thing like that you found while like, researching this project? What was your favorite thing about it?
I enjoyed learning about how they worked with Alexis because he was somebody that I like knew about before this project, so it was cool to see how it kind of like connected with that. Yeah, that's a good question.
What was your favorite thing that you learned?
Probably learning about France's love for big birds.
Has there been something that drew you to learning about these?
I found it interesting to learn about like a couple, because generally for conservation it's always like one person that you're looking into. So I liked the idea of seeing like both of their sides of the story and how they ended up doing the same thing. I thought that was cool to learn about.
We have time for one more question. Otherwise, if you're giving feedback, make sure you finish your feedback forms for Eden and Sam. When you're finished, pass them to your right so I can. Wait, no, to your left. I'm sorry. I went to the other. I went like this for some reason. To the left. No, I would like them for Alexis and for these two. Alright, thank you guys. Whenever you're ready, ma'am. You got this!
I lost the note card, that's all.
Oh, okay.
This is my environmental charter school. I'm in the ninth grade. I have approximately, probably now, like 100 hours in this charter. What is eco-feminism? The idea of eco-feminism is women in nature being equals. Being one and the same, like the idea that the past idea was that women and nature were abused by people in general. Now it's a lot more positive. It's about women and nature having similar qualities and trying to survive in society that is male dominated. And that goes into the two types of ecofeminism. Like one is radical, which was women seeing the idea that they were equals by society as a negative impact by them having the idea that women in nature can use and just like, taken for granted. But then cultural ecofeminism was the positive idea of that women in nature are equals because of their nurturing qualities and their biology. And just overall, women have kind of sacred empathy for nature, wildlife. And it is also more about today intersectionality. So like an example I've used is my garden of hive, which I will talk about later. She helped encourage women to plant over 30 million trees in Kenya, which is, and she is also an African American woman. So she
she definitely represents intersectionality in ecofeminism.
Women in ecofeminism.
This is my yarn, the five that we just previously talked about. She was the founder of the Green Belt Movement, which is, again, a movement or an organization that helps to empower women to care for nature and with the trees. She actually worked with women all across the world, and they actually ended up planting over 11 billion trees across the world. And she also here is winning the 2004 Nobel Peace Prize for her works with the Green Belt Movement and the women to plant these trees. Her education was many degrees at many different colleges that eventually helped her to become the chair of the veterinary department and actually become the first woman to gain a doctorate. And she also had many books. She wrote the book, The Green Belt Movement, The Challenge for Africa, and a couple others. This is Rachel Carson. She always had a love for nature growing up, which definitely reflected in her work for wildlife and humanity and nature. She when she graduated from Pennsylvania University in 1929, she went on to earn her zoology degree at the Johns Hopkins University through her work at the Marine Biology Lab. One of the most notable things she did, in my opinion, was her fight against DDT, which was a harmful pesticide that ended up hurting a lot of animals and ultimately humans. And in her book, Silent Spring, which is to the right, that was talking all about the dangers of this pesticide and eventually got the use of that pesticide banned in the U.S. and other countries. So that is not used today, and that is definitely helping humanity and nature. This is Jane Goodall. She had always grown up with a interest for wildlife, and she had a dream of traveling to Kenya to work with wildlife and chimpanzees. And she was actually told that it was too dangerous for women to go there, but she ultimately proved them wrong by raising enough money over years to get to travel there. And when she got there, she was chosen to go work with these animals in Tanzania by a prehistoric human scientist. And she was actually chosen just to bring it back to cultural eco-feminism and the idea. She was actually chosen because he believed that a woman would have more empathy towards these animals and clearly be able to connect better with these animals through her empathy. And when she got there, it was a little difficult for her. It took a long time for her to connect to these animals, but in the results of eventually connecting to those animals, she was actually the initial person that found out that these animals, chimpanzees, have independent personalities, much like humans. And today she still works with these animals and fights for wildlife in general with opening up the Jane Goodall Foundation. Eco-Feminist organization. This is the Women's Environmental Development Organization. We do this. Their mission is to teach the links between women's rights and social and environmental rights. And they're also trying to show that women and these rights are linked to each other. And their vision was to want to promote gender equality and the environment and people. Bella Abzug, who was their founder, or the U.S. founder, was the House of Representatives and was represented in Congress for 3 times and has always been an advocate for women's rights. This organization. Other action was campaigning for global climate justice, which was meant to help women fight for climate change and to help raise awareness for the problems that they are facing. WeCan is a women's urgent climate action network. Their mission is to get women involved in environmental projects and to have women be involved in decisions made about climate change and the environment rather than having men or people direct them make decisions. And their action was actually taking women to destruction of forests, and they went to forests. I know there was one in Brazil, and there was one in Africa. So they've kind of been all over the world trying to make change against destroying these forests and trying to have them in the first place. The Global Green Grants Fund is trying to give resources to places that don't have a lot of equity, so or that resources that can't be accessed specifically by these people to create more equity throughout communities, and also having environmental rights in all countries and having women kind of lead this change. And one of their actions was fighting to protect the livelihood of farmers, fishers, and local employment. So on their website, they had talked about how a lot of these professions are being destroyed in their communities because of the destruction of wildlife and nature. And Honor the Earth, this is an organization that tries to fight for problems that Native people have to deal with. So they want to make a voice for people that are not heard in this group of women or people in general. And this organization was started by Winona Duke, who's the one here. She worked with the indigenous people to raise awareness for their issues and to help these people and their culture. And the Indigo Girls were another group of people she worked with, and their mission was kind of to protect the land for animals and wildlife rather than to just be used to be cut down. And that eventually opened up this organization, which added to their mission. One of the actions they did was they fought against people that were going to build oil pipelines through their camps and the space that they used. And ultimately, it would hurt the environment and a lot of people. So they wanted to fight against that, which they eventually did end up winning, and those pipelines were built. And this is a local example. Alice's Garden, they work towards giving a food source to people in the Milwaukee area that have a lot of poverty, and just another food source for them to use and for them to sustain off of. And another really cool thing about them is they use all environmental friendly to help grow their plants. The one right here, she was the founder, but now there is another main director, which I don't remember her name, unfortunately, but she is no longer the director, but she was the one who did it. And then why is this important? Eco-feminism is important because this is all about women helping make change in their communities and ultimately the world. And this is, and small acts like Alice's Garden that are helping their family lives are eventually helping the entire world by using less pesticides, using more sustainable and environmentally friendly products. And also in the future, I think if we could see more of these small acts, I think this could improve the world, our future, and for generations to come, because we always want to be thinking about the future, as we were saying this morning. And I think this definitely is helping, and I think if we could see more of that, it would help the other businesses. Any questions? Special thanks to Tiffany, because she gave me a lot of, a majority of my resources and information for this project, because she was short in women's rights.
Thank you.
Okay.
Minutes for questions.
Is this a career that you want to pursue, and is there any, through any of the organizations that you mentioned, do you want to become a part of that?
I think it would definitely be interesting to become a part of that. I think what a lot of these organizations are doing are really cool. Like with Alice's Garden, she was a woman with an idea, not somebody like Jane Goodall, who is widely known. But I think it would be interesting to do this.
Uh,
So is this part of a bigger project, or is this the main project idea? It's just focusing on that.
Yes, this is a part of my capstone, my women's rights capstone. I took this small portion of the project out for New Summit to have a more environmental aspect. But yes, this is a part of a bigger project, and this is just one of the topics that I've been talking about in my main project.
Alexis, was your 100 hours just for this part of your capstone, or for all of it?
This is for the total part of it. This portion of it, I couldn't tell you because I took from the whole project, which I probably should have taken out part of this project.
You an eco-feminist?
I
would you consider yourself one?
I believe I am a feminist that believes in environmental change. I have not, like, of course, with this project, I'm trying to teach about this, but it's not like I've done any action towards this. But I think it would be interesting to help with that. And I consider myself a feminist. For me right now.
In the beginning of it, you said that you had two different versions of eco-feminism. Would you consider yourself one of those, or or would you relate to one?
I think I relate to culture more because I think this definitely is supposed to be a negative impact. I think it's supposed to be more of a like, hey, we are one and the same. It isn't supposed to be a negative idea. It's more supposed to be we are similar and we're working with two different species to kind of help. So I definitely relate to one more. I think radical ecofeminism was definitely relevant back when this was first an idea, but I don't think now as much.
Dill, would you yourself like pursue a business on trying to get people friends and things? Just want to become a part of it as a person there.
I think this would be really cool to start an organization. I don't know if that's amenable right now, but I think it definitely is a cool idea and something that would be really interesting to pursue or create, because I think even small organizations like Alice's Garden and big organizations to Jane Goodall's Foundation, I think it was, is as a whole helping in general. But it would definitely be something I'd be interested in, like I said, with the next question.
How has this project, not just this particular portion on ecofeminism, but your project, your larger project on feminism, how has this changed your perspective about being a woman?
I think I have definitely always been a person that's been labeled. And I think it's definitely really cool to see people that are taking labels that have been given to them and taking it as like positive or like kind of ignoring it. I think it's definitely made me a stronger person just thinking about how people, like I know I read about a woman who was just basically degraded for being a woman and fighting for something, and I know there's a lot of women that are dealing with that, and I think it's really cool to see these women actually being able to pursue and stuff like that.
Alright. Susan is watching and she has been sending us feedback as you guys are getting done. We're going to share that out with you. Mr. Prim's emailing it out to all of you guys. But she's been like texting us like feedback about each of your presentations. It's been really kind of cool to see. So if you can pass back your, those of you that did the feedback form for Paris, I will take those. Thank you. Next up is Aidan. Yeah.
Go for it, Aidan.
Got this, Aidan.
We love you. You are good people.
No, Susan, we're totally fine with you texting your comments. We don't mind that at all. We just don't want you to feel like we're ignoring you, because we are going to share them out with the kids so that they can hear your awesome feedback.
Make sure to be loud and proud.
Word!
And there's 10 people watching right
now. Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that is cool. Dang, girl, you got a lot of feedback for us. All right, whenever you're ready.
name is Aidan. I am a student at Marq Environmental Charter School, and this is my presentation on scale models for hands-on and visual learners. All right, so first of all, what are scale models? So scale models are generally a physical representation of something, and that something can be almost anything from continents to planes, trains, maybe even cells, or, you know, maybe an eye, or even a solar system or a planet. But in order for it to be a scale model, it has to either be a scaled down version or a scaled up version of said thing, said object. And, you know, if you were making a scale model of a planet, you would most likely be scaling it down, seeing as planets are huge. But if you're maybe making a scale model of a cell, you'd want to probably scale it up, you know. Well, you probably have to, I'd say. So, why scale models are important? So, scale models are important for a variety of reasons, a few reasons are they are used to help. They can be used to help explain or help to visualize. So, an example, architects, when, you know, designing buildings, sure, you can just design a building on paper, but, you know, you may, like, when you're designing something on paper, it's kind of hard to really visualize what that end product will look like. So, a lot of times, architects will actually create physical models of, you know, buildings or whatever. To help kind of visualize that, and, you know, maybe they'll see certain flaws, or, you know, that can also be a way of kind of showing off to, you know, maybe clients and whatnot what the building will actually look like. And another example being engineers. When an engineer, you know, is kind of designing something, using scale models can be a way of prototyping. And again, similar to, you know, archetypes, they can also be used to kind of visualize what that product will look like and get that, you know, full 3D view of what it will look like. And scale models can also be functional, so you can actually see how that product or, you know, item might actually function. So for my sustainability focus, so with this presentation, I'm kind of focusing on how scale models can be used for education. For my sustainability focus, I'm kind of focusing on how educators can use scale models to engage students in a more sustainable way, so that the way students are actually kind of retaining information and actually more engaged in what they're learning. And there are many different ways that scale models can be used in many different topics. For instance, they could be used for science, you know, like I kind of talked about earlier, cells, or even, you know, scale model of an eye, or they can be used for geography, you know, globes, and, you know, even teaching engineering, like I talked about earlier, you know. And scale models, or at least, you know, working with scale models also involves a lot of math, seeing as you have to scale every, you know, proportion of the object. So, you know, and you can use scale models to teach math, or you can use math to create scale models. So what I have made, so for this project, actually, that I originally made for a different project, using for this project. So I made two different scale models of two-stroke engines. And in this case, I made one out of wood. So, you know, just kind of a basic material that a lot of people, you know, have worked with. And I also 3D printed this one. And 3D printing is kind of, you know, really kind of, you know, getting more and more, you know, widespread, and a lot more people are working with it. And especially since I was able to print this on a 3D printer I bought for $180. So not very much, you know. So, you know, most schools can, you know, afford that. So that way, you know, educators and students are able to 3D print, you know, models to help educate each other. For this project, I mostly focused on making scale models, and also, you know, with this presentation a bit on, you know, using them for, you know, anything really, you know, education and creating things, whatnot. Scott?
How did you get interested in this, and are you going to look into doing scale models in the future as an engineering student?
I originally got interested in this when I was young. I went to like a model railroading convention, and I just thought it was really cool. So then I actually did a bit of creating my own kind of like landscape scale models, and then I just kind of forgot about it, and now kind of came back to it years later. And I think in my future I will definitely be working with scale models, but I don't think that's going to be like my job is creating them. But I will, you know, probably be using them to, like, you know, prototype whatnot. So I have a bit of interest in engineering. Jillian?
Is there something from this project that you are or could take out and be able to take for yourself when going into making scale models, or when, like, is there something that you found out in this project that helped you improve your scale models or make you more interested in them?
I think just doing this project in general has kind of interested me in the topic. And also, like, you know, a while ago, I was only generally working with creating landscape scale models, but now I know there's all sorts of different types of scale models. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Okay. Jared? So it's kind of a two-part question. What is the favorite scale model you've ever built, and then what is the favorite one you've ever seen?
Favorite one I've ever built? Not really sure. I haven't made, like, you know, crazy amount. I don't know. I mean, I really enjoyed making that wooden two-stroke engine. I think that was pretty, satisfying. It was done. But favorite one I've ever seen? I don't know. I haven't, you know, seen a whole lot that, like, I can remember off the top of my head, but I think, you know, just going to those model railroad conventions, there's some really cool models there that are pretty interesting, pretty big too.
Okay, I'm gonna have you guys ask your questions later, because it is, we gotta have one more presentation before lunch. So, thank you, Aidan.
Can I ask him very good?
Go find Aidan at lunchtime, and then you can ask him those questions. All right, finally, before lunch, we have Dee Dee presenting. If you filled out the feedback form for Aidan, please send them my way.
Mm-hmm. sustainability focus is how dress code changed over the years and are they more focused on girls' clothing. The pillar that I'm connecting to is economic change and how is by taking action within my school to make a difference. And then my learning target for this project is identifying social concepts and their development over time. What is dress code? Dress code is usually a strict set of particular rules focused around dress. Example, what is and isn't allowed to be worn. History of dress code. The first ever dress code was established in 1969 by the U.S. Supreme Court. When dress codes were first established, they were very strict. I'll pass around a sheet showing three different time frames and dress code policies. And within these, you can ask questions as they're being passed around. The first section shows you the very strict 1960s to 1970s dress code. The second column shows my school's dress code, school district dress code in 2016-2017. And number three shows you our current dress code. As you can tell, each dress code is very different. The first two you see focus mostly on the girl's side and less on the boys. The last one shows an all-around gender equal dress code. The change in schools you see today regarding dress has become more equal and less boy versus girl. Public versus parochial. Public versus parochial, or private school, has been a debate for decades. Some believe a private education is better than a public education. Uniforms. The word most kids dress. As most of you know, if not all, parochial schools have uniforms. Why? Because some say if they all dress the same, they, one, have less distractions with clothing, and two, less bullying for the less fortunate kids who can't afford fashion-forward clothes. And as you can see, parochial school only has one option for a girl's dress and two options for the boy's dress. In public schools, we have a wide choice of outfits, but whether they're in dress code is the question. As you can also tell, parochial school's uniforms are expensive. The first shirt that you see is the polo, which are $10 to $24. The plaid pants can be $32 to $43. The button-down shirt for women is $19 to $29. The skirts are $23 to $50. The blazer is $81 to $109. And the khakis are $15 to $66, and their shoes can be $15 to $66. So everything is what the students have to pay for. For the uniforms, their tuition doesn't cover it. Dress code versus freedom of speech. The case known as Tinker versus Des Moines Independent School District involved several high school students who wore black armbands in the school in a planned protest against the Vietnam War. Not all speech is protected in a school setting. For example, students that wear clothes that follow the latest fashion trends, such as oversized shirts and slouchy pants for boys, or short skirts and crop tops for girls, or clothing that supports certain religion or political views, may be prohibited in school dress code policies if the student's choice of clothing causes distractions. The ruling in the case Tinker versus Des Moines was that the First Amendment right held their position to wear the armbands as long as it wasn't disruptive. How dress code impacts learning. Whether or not an article of clothing is appropriate is completely subjective. Parents will even approve of the outfit, but the admin will not. Pulling a student out of class to change in the office or go home and change takes away valuable class time, which can then result in lower grades or test scores, and so much more. How dress code can be and is sexist. In almost every dress code policy, you see that the girls' list of prohibited clothing is longer than the boys'. Like the image below, I took a survey within my school on how many boys versus girls have been dress coded, and if they were daily, whether their outfits will be called out or not. Right here. And those. Professional views. I interviewed our former principal and and district administrator as live resources for my capstone. I asked them 8 questions, 5 of which revolved around dress code, but I chose 3 of the questions that I thought fit best for today. As I hand out the responses to my questions, you'll see they have very similar but very different questions, or answers to the question. How you can take action. Talk to your principal or superintendent, see what are some things you can do to start or inspire change. Send out a survey to your peers and staff and get their views on the topic. Draw out a plan for how you would like the topic that you are trying to make a difference in, so you know how you would like things to go. And then once you get the okay, put your plan into action and watch the change begin within your school. Sources, I think. My sources, the list is very long, so I printed them out, so I have them. Thank you for watching. Any questions? And this is an ongoing project, so I'm still working on it.
All right, 5 minutes for questions.
Why should we care?
I think you should care because dress code is a very big topic within schools, and some schools have dress codes. I've seen some schools in Florida have a rule where girls are not allowed to wear shorts because they're too distracting to the boys. So I feel like caring about dress code is a lot of people can take change and help within change within schools to getting more gender equal dress codes so girls aren't so targeted. Because with stuff like this, it's kind of like a blame the victim case where it's like it's girls' fault if boys get distracted. I wanted to do this project because, one, I really like doing projects on controversial topics and things that people don't really like talking about. And I feel like doing this project will show people that if you put effort into it, you can really make a change within your school. And I have been dress coded a few times because of the rips in my jeans being too high or my shirt being too low cut. So I've been dress coded for that, and I feel like, and then there was a boy with a cut off, they could see something through, but he wasn't dress coded, so I felt like that was very unfair.
With the boys getting distracted thing, was that something that was proven or was that something that people just assumed happened?
Well, with many of the articles I read, it all had almost the same exact wording, like to blame the victim, because I feel if girls wear shorts or a low-cut top or a belly shirt, that the boys get distracted because the boys, or the word that was said is boys will be boys. So basically saying like boys will do what they want, but if girls do what they want, it's wrong.
Yes, but was that proven that?
I'm not exactly sure if it was, but that's how they like view like most. Like that was in most articles how they view like how girls dress is distracting, but I'm not sure.
Did you look into like, not specifically, a problem that I know has been around is about like PE with dress code, because sometimes the dress code isn't always exactly helped just because you're running around and everything.
I didn't really look into that.
Okay.
But I feel like, yeah, you have a good point there. Like the shorts rule, like if you can't have shorts a certain length out in the hall, why can you have them in gym? But that I didn't really look into. I was focusing more on like dress code. Schools, but that's
part of school,
but that'd be something I could look into.
Yeah. So, these sheets are just kind of confusing me. Like, I see, what's your gender identity? I see the statistic there, but I'm not seeing that being related to any other thing here. Did you pick through it and see how many percent are men, how many percent are women, how many percent are non-binary?
I just put the, I tried to put it as like, where each question had like what the gender was, but
also really confused because I see, how do you know about dress code for your outfit? 56.3% of 16 people, yes. 43.8% said no. Never mind. This makes sense. Of course I do.
We have time for one more question.
As a graduating senior who has gone through 6 years at Highmark and grown tremendously in that time, do you have any words of wisdom for all these young whippersnappers in the audience?
Well, I'd say if you see an issue within your school that you want to change or make a difference in, put your heart into it and you can make a change and make that difference. It doesn't matter what you're doing.
I'm just getting really emotional right now because, like, you've
like
grown so
rounds.
Much.
I want
to
give that like
10
rounds of applause.
Yeah, like, it's really great to see how much you've grown since the seventh grader. Like,
yeah.
Just ignore me. I'm
yeah.
Just crying back here. It's fine.
Yep, yep.
It's fine. That's all.
Thank you.
You all will have that too.
Oh, you can play it. To Alexis, she seemed really relaxed in her presentation, and I am glad she doesn't hate cranes anymore.
Yeah, they are.
Sam and Eden worked really well together. I like how they reworked their slides for the group project. Nicely done. Paris did great. She touched on many of my heroes. Good questions from the students. Powerful response from Ms. Bolin's question. Aidan did a nice job working through his nervousness. Very cool project. And she says she'll be back after a lunch break. But now she says, oh, I will wait, because she's watching. Maybe she'll get some feedback for Dee Dee in a second that I can share. Meanwhile, I'll just do the Eden dance.
Oh, good. Jillian, you have a great question. Can you ask that Mr. Brim can answer for you?
We sure are.
Okay.
You guys can cut it now. That's, but yeah, we're good. Thank you.
So the bell's going to ring. For those of you that need to go and get a hot lunch, please make sure that you go down and get a hot lunch. Please don't leave this room in like a disaster. So before the bell rings,
can we get
chairs stacked, because then we can just make this an open space for people to have lunch. You can also eat in my advisory. It's just a little nutty right now, my advisory. So
before you leave,
I didn't know when you said you would move yet. Go sit back down, please.
did a nice job of organizing and outlining her presentation. I like that she provided an idea or tool on what people can do to address the issue. I really